Are you guys just sitting in here to, you know, relax, or are you
listening? We're going to be microbe dogs.
Okay, all right, that's fine.
Microbes? With this crew?
You don't like microbes.
I thought you said micro dots.
Oh, that'd be a whole different kind of thing.
Yes, it's dark in here because this is the microdosing tent.
Right.
Check, check.
All right, welcome everybody to the 1:30 panel on soil microbe communities. I'm your MC for the discussion, Shane Golos. I'm the host of the Shaping Fire podcast. If you enjoy learning from the top minds in the cannabis business, I encourage you to visit shapingfire.com to enjoy in-depth interviews on cannabis business, health, and technique that will provide you with actual information without wasting your time. Recent guests have included cultivator Kevin Jodry, the godfather of cannabis terpenes, neurologist Dr. Ethan Russo, geneticist Dr. Reggie Gaudino on cannabis plant patents, cannabis breeder Mean Gene from Mendocino, Natasha Riz on using the cannabis root as medicine, and many, many others, including panelist Jeff Lowenfels, and coming up soon, Colin Bell from Mammoth Microbes. So if you like these guys, you'll probably enjoy the show. There's postcards for the show right next to the entry that you can pick up on your way out. So if you want to share this presentation with others who are not here today, the video of this presentation will find its way to my YouTube channel next week. And you can find that channel at youtube.com/ShangoLos. And again, if you're not going to remember my name, just pick up a postcard. It's got my name on there as well. So please put your phones on vibrate if you haven't already. And hold your questions to the end. We'll have a little bit of time at the end for those. But, you know, considering we've got three epic living soil folks here in 45 minutes, we want to let them get as much in as they can. So introductions. Jeff Lowenfels is a reformed lawyer and author of the award-winning and best-selling books Teeming with Microbes, The Organic Gardener's Guide to the Soil Food Web, Teeming with Nutrients, The Organic Gardener's Guide to Optimizing Plant Nutrition, and his third book in the Soils Trilogy, Teeming with Fungi, The Organic Grower's Guide to Mycorrhiza, which was published in January and instantly became a bestseller. Jeff also pens the longest-running garden column in North America, having never missed a week in 40 years. And I love this part. In 2005, he was inducted into the Garden Writers of America Hall of Fame, the highest honor a garden writer can attain. Colin Bell is the co-founder, co-inventor, and chief growth officer at Growcentia, the parent company of Mammoth Microbes, which you've more likely heard of more. Colin completed his PhD in soil microbial ecology in 2009, and as a researcher scientist at Colorado State University, Colin published dozens of peer-reviewed publications that were focused on elucidating microbial-mediated processes that enhance plant growth. Colin left his academic position at Colorado State University in March 2015 to launch Growcentia. Their first product, Mammoth P, is a beneficial bacterial bloom stimulant that targets phosphorus cycling to maximize both quality and quantity of yield in cannabis plants. Thousands of producers around the world are now using this, reporting overwhelming positive results, including in my home garden. Mammoth P is now sold in over 900 stores globally. Finally, John Picciarelli is founder of Cutting Edge Solutions. As an early adopter of the soil food web system, his business drive is rooted in sustainable agriculture. John helped to develop the Cutting Edge product line to support natural soil ecology, including their flagship product, Hum Tea, and co-founded a microbiology lab in 2004 to support their research efforts. One of John's current side projects is growing milkweed and a variety of pollen-producing flowers for migrating monarch butterflies. Let's offer the panel a warm welcome. So the way that we're going to do the panel today is we're going to start off by asking a question to one of our panelists, and then the other two panelists will have an opportunity to lean in on that as well. So the first question is going to go start with Jeff, and then we'll work our way this way. So be patient with this first question. It's got kind of a long setup, but here you go. So
a very short attention span.
Very short. So in a commercial growing operation, conservation of resources, including time and money, is vital. And changing from traditional cannabis growing techniques consisting of bottled salt and nutrients to instead using holistic growing techniques that can bring the soil alive can seem differently expensive in time, training, and changes to operating procedures. Management often resists making the switch because they're afraid of the risk involved with doing something differently when so much is on the line. Jeff, can focusing on building thriving microbe communities in a commercial operation substrates be financially beneficial in addition to just being more natural?
Yes. No, of course it can. And I think the reason comes down to something that people in California are going to experience pretty darn soon, and people in Washington State and people in Alaska as well. The idea of selling a product that's not organic, and you need microbes to make the product organic as far as I'm concerned, is just death to the person who's smoking or vaporizing or eating your product if it's not processed properly. And so I think the regulatory organizations are going to require a microbial-based approach to growing cannabis if you're going to sell it as a medicine for sure and recreational product.
Okay, I'll comment on that also. I think that, you know, with any kind of management, there's a process, and anyone would be resistant to a complete turnover without understanding the value, but I think there's actually a real value, and we've done a lot of studies now where we look at different management practices, and we get different characteristics of the plant and the final quality and yield of plants based on these different management practices. So I think it's going to take the process and the evolution of owners of cultivation facilities to understand what that value proposition is and how these different management practices may be a conversion for this conversation from a more mineral or traditional cultivation to more of an organic, incorporating microbes and incorporating more natural processes into the cultivation practices will support better quality and allow the plant to maximize its phenotypic potential. So you're getting the qualities out of the plant for which you want it bred. I think I've seen a lot of data now that really surprises me and encourages me that as we transition to more organic practices, we do see more quality, more terpene profiles without sacrificing yield. And in many cases, when we dial that in, we can get as good of yield or even better yield increases with that quality metric. So tying quality to those management practices and value is where that transition is going to occur, in my opinion.
And there have been quite a few studies. I don't know, does anyone here know who Elaine Ingman is?
Yeah.
That's great, somebody raised their hand, because I was at the National Heirloom Expo, my company's over in Santa Rosa, and happens to be at the fairgrounds, and there were like 300 people, and no one raised their hand except me. What Colin's saying about the data and the studies, you know, they're fairly recent. It wasn't just 2003, I mean, here we are in Richmond, Albany's next door, and that's where the USDA lab is that decided to study compost tea, and their study was really interesting. Not that you would ever do this at home, but they took chicken shit and put it in water and then added molasses and decided that compost tea is really E. coli. And Elaine Ingman, who was at Corvallis, the University of Oregon then, countered that. And so, you know, there's quite a bit of back and forth between her and this one scientist. Strangely enough, his last name was Stanker. But you can only imagine the stank of that their particular compost tea. Now, many years have passed, and scientists like Colin have gotten involved, and Jeff, you know, he was one of the early people. In fact, I met him at Soul Food Lab, I think, in 98 or 99. And so there's been a lot of dedicated people that have shown that using compost teas and making good quality compost is a start in the right direction. And then of course there's products that, as you can probably hear from Colin, that have come out that his company makes, or that Hum Tea is an example of that too. Organisms that have come from good compost that are able to break down the nutrients that you're amending the soil with. So saving the soil indoors has become a possibility.
Go ahead and hold on to that mic, John.
Oh, that's scary.
Yeah, totally. It, conveniently, the next question starts with you. So much of the market for flower is based on bag appeal, and many consider frosty flowers and intense coloration to be a result of intense synthetic nutrients. What can commercial scale growers do to create frosty flowers with great bag appeal while also respecting the health of the substrate microbe communities?
Well, probably the most important thing that some sort of commercial fertilizer person could ever tell you is that it's rooted in manganese. Manganese is a key micronutrient that basically all plants use, and produce an enzyme that acts like a catalyst and then lets nitrogen up into the plant through the cells without burning them. So if you have the right level of manganese, you're not getting tip burn. And you're not getting this slight curling or this slight interveinal yellowing. You know this if you actually sent in leaf samples and had a nutritional profile done that way. So manganese is very important in the Cannabaceae family and well studied in hops. And the two plants in the Cannabaceae family are hops and cannabis. Well, you need manganese to make, for the plants to make two coenzymes that boost the terpene profile. And when the terpene profile is boosted, you'll see more stalk glandular trichomes, or what people call crystals. And you need to fill those with something. Those are resins. So in terms of bag appeal, you're looking for manganese. How do you get this? Well, pretty much everything on the market is manganese EETA. So I worked on a bioaccumulation process to come up with an organic form of manganese. And now there's other products too that are amino acid chelated that are also, you know, organic and allowed too. So people are looking at manganese more for that bag appeal.
Yeah, I want to comment on my experience. I end up now with this company, Mammoth Microbes, traveling all over the world, working with growers through South America, through Europe, and of course in the U.S. And I think this transition and maybe this this note of bag appeal is going to be more ephemeral than we think, although everyone wants to see really nice looking flowers. I've seen pushback also from people who don't feel like it's as natural as it could be, and there's this pushback for PGRs. Where it's turned into a negative thing if the butt actually looks too good. People have come up to me in several occasions now, recently, showing me this flower, and I don't know who's grown it, and they're asking me, is this natural, is this organically grown, because it just looks too good. What I will say, and I hear this across the world from growers and consumers, is people want quality. Yield is becoming easier to attain, but we're trying to maximize quality, not only quality as far as the medicinal property of the different cannabinoids, and THC is a quality metric, and CBD is a quality metric, and there's many, many other cannabinoids, but then these terpene qualities and these terpene smells that turn into and translate to flavor. And a lot of consumers really want that more so than a good looking bud. And that's just my personal opinion that I formed over the last year when I've actually engaged in a broader audience than I'm used to engaging in. And I think we achieve that by transitioning to more natural solutions and liberating and delivering the micronutrients, which I think is a huge missing component. If it's missing, we're gonna see clear negative results. I'll refer to those as negative results in quality and the profile that we want out of our flowers. And so that transition into quality is what I think is gonna be the continued value that's gonna distinguish cultivators from maybe a bag appeal to a real product that people want to continue to purchase.
May that transition happen swiftly.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, I almost forgot the question here, but I think, I agree with your answers. I would add boron, incidentally. If you don't have boron, you don't get a flower. A problem I see is that, yeah, people want to know what they're smoking. So I'm going to just sort of shift this a little bit. So they look at numbers. You know, hopefully we're going to start looking at terpene profiles, because that's really where it's at. I agree with you 100%. It's not sativa or indica. It's what the terpene profile is and how they mix together. It's also the age of the flower, so that if you get a flower where all the trichomes are brown, you're going to get a little indica kind of heavy stone, and if they're still crystally, you're going to get a much higher up stone. But the problem I see is that the government that we own is not going to care whether you want to see the flower or not to be able to tell what you're buying. In California, I understand they're going to seal them up. No more jars, no more smelling, no more looking, which is what they do in Washington State. It is the worst experience to go into a Washington State cannabis store and buy cannabis. You get this piece of plastic, you don't know what's behind it, you don't know how old it is, you don't know what it looks like or what it smells like. It's crazy, it's stupid. And it's happening here in California because everybody's sitting on their hands instead of telling the California people, hey, we're the owners of this government and we don't want to do it that way. Everybody's just very, very quiet. So I'm just mentioning that, but I agree with all of your answers, and I don't know if I added anything or not. There are three books that I wrote And you know, they support everything that this gentleman does and that this gentleman does. You know, if you don't know how your plants are getting their food organically, you need to learn that. If you don't know what nutrients your plant needs and what each individual nutrient does and how it does it, so that you know, for example, that if your temperature is between 76 and 78, you're at the optimum because the enzyme production is working. You've got to know this stuff, and then you end up organically with a plant that is natural, that has all of the trichomes that it's supposed to have on it, that does its thing.
I just want to tag on that, the reference to the books, not that I'm plugging Jeff or his work, but I will say, you know, I've read a lot of books, I have a PhD in microbiology, so I've read a lot of pretty dense books, and I got a lot out of them, and I probably got more out of reading Jeff's books because of the level of knowledge and the digestibility that he presents information, so I think they're excellent resources, and I really appreciate you putting those out. Thanks a lot.
They're incredible books, and it's amazing to find a book that actually has the depth if you're experienced, but also is written in a way that a layperson can read them as well and get a lot out of them. So they're good for both pros, and if you're a pro, you've probably already read them, and for newbies as well. So, Colin, while you've got the mic there, so establishing a commercial operation can seem like a long-term project, and it is. But at some point, cultivators who want to make the switch to probiotic growing techniques have to make the jump. Like, today is the day we're going to do it and get up to high yields and repeatable results fast. What advice would you give to a cultivator ready to make the switch to probiotic so they quickly achieve a baseline of production that they can refine over time?
So that's a really good question, and I think about that question and answering in terms of a process. You know, I don't think anyone can afford, we're, no matter what we're doing, what business we're in, and cultivation is a business, we have to mitigate risk versus reward. And switching everything without having a baseline of competence is very, very risky. And so I think any professional business, no matter what switch it is, even in my manufacturing company, we manufacture microbes, you grow up microbes, it looks like a microbrew operation, change anything. I experiment with some solutions, get the data, and then I inform our changes based on the data we collect. And if it's a positive move, I incorporate that to a larger scale, and I think that's the same thing that any cultivator is gonna do. And every cultivator we work with on a large scale typically has experimental rooms, and they'll experiment with solutions. I think that there's a lot of great products out there that allow traditional cannabis growers using mineral or synthetics to incorporate steps using microbes and natural processes, so you can start to get that confidence that, wow, there is benefit in using microbes. There are benefits in adding these organic additives that allow me to get value. And that's where I think that the products that we make and products in the market in general that are microbial-based and natural-based do a real service for the impact I wanted to make as a microbiologist in academia, which is to start to educate and bridge natural processes into conventional agriculture. And allowing to have the products that are compatible, that are very effective, and that are very low risk and high reward, meaning that you can add them in, not change a thing, and see these results, is a very good step. The next step, when we start talking about outside of additives, which is pretty easy, is the infrastructure and the living soil or the beds or however these processes are, and that's another level of commitment. But I think the step is understanding that there is value and then buying into it and taking that next, making that next investment in time and money to create the next round of substrate, organic substrate growing conditions to really embrace organic growing.
Sure, I guess I'm next. Completely agree with Colin. You know, it's hard to sometimes convince owners or investors to follow any kind of living soil bed, or even to use microbes, or even use Mammoth P or Hum Tea. One of the ways that I bridge that is by showing them, when they're indoor cultivators, they have sealed rooms. Well, when they have sealed rooms, they have to add CO2. So if you can show them their own data logger, a lot of times, surprisingly, people that have spent $30 million on their grow facility don't even know what the equipment is that is in the grow facility. It's good to walk them through it. Show them how the data logger works. Show them the CO2 levels. And I know from experience that when you use Mammoth P and Home T in a, not only just a living soil bed, but in, say, a well-gulled soil bed, there's enough carbon there that the microbes break down to give off CO2. So you can see CO2 levels hit 3,000 parts per million, way over what you need. The reader, once it's at 1,400, is going to click off and not add any more CO2 in the room. The advantage, they save a tiny bit of money, but you're showing them that the microbes are working and doing something. And one of the important nutrients for plants is CO2, is carbon. So they can readily see the plants green up, grow healthier, just by having those higher levels of CO2 than you would naturally have in the very beginning. Also, in rooms like that, even if they're 500 light rooms, you find that that CO2 lasts for 3 to 5 hours before the regular CO2 kicks on. So, you're already showing them something. And, this is a show me industry. People, we were talking about bag appeal a minute ago, but now we're talking about microbe appeal. And that's part of it, is just showing them something simple like that.
So in my talks on cannabis, which I don't often always give, I talk to a lot of garden clubs and little old ladies and tennis teachers and stuff. But when I talk to the cannabis group, I now show a picture of a leaf from one of my plants that I grew last summer. And I struggle with it to show how big the picture the leaf is. And this is a leaf from a plant where I used a mycorrhizal fungi, whereas before I hadn't been using the mycorrhizal fungi. And the leaf I first show next to one of my books, and it covers the entire book. But you don't really get a feel for it, how big's that book. And so I go through my head, it covers my entire head. And then I take a cast iron frying pan. You all know how big those are. This leaf covers the entire frying pan. And I say to people, if you don't believe in mycorrhizal fungi, then you're not looking at these pictures the proper way. We know they work. We know that Mammoth P works. The cannabis industry is full of the finest growers in the world, bar none. This industry has experimented more than agriculture has. This industry is more conversant, shares more information than the agricultural industry does. There seems to be very little concern about competition between growers. People talk, they join associations, et cetera, et cetera. And we are so much more advanced in terms of using the things that Bayer, which I guess we ought to call Bayer, and the Scotts Miracle-Gro folks are all starting to get into. We've been doing this as an industry with smaller companies for years and years and years. So I don't think there should be any problem whatsoever convincing a cannabis grower on a commercial basis that all of this stuff makes sense, this stuff works. There is a backup document study by numbers of growers that they can talk to on everything that's available, because if it doesn't work in this industry, it doesn't stick around, with a couple of exceptions, maybe Miracle-Gro and some of that other stuff. But even that stuff, people realize, doesn't work the way this other stuff does. And you learn, we read the magazines, we listen, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I don't think it's going to be a problem here.
Fantastic. So first off, the fact that we are doing a panel with this much experience in 45 minutes is a sin, right? But we're going to work with what we've got. So what we're going to do is we're going to ask one more question formally and then bring the mic out to you, because I know that you're going to have questions. So start formulating now, and I'll be right with you. So the last question for you fellas, and this is one I didn't let you know about in advance, so you're going to have to work extemporaneous with me, is...
You let us know questions in advance.
Well, you didn't check your email, John. So
shooting from the hip.
But here, this
oh, so I get it.
Yeah, it looks like it.
Oh, great.
So you guys are asked questions often. You're on podcasts. You're public speakers like this, and we all tend to sometimes ask you the same things over and over. What is something that you are working on, or that you've realized yourself recently, that you are excited about that I should be asking you? Something that you are personally jacked up about and excited that you just want to break out to us right now because you've got an opportunity.
So Jeff, a giant leaf. Is that Alaskan thunderfuck?
No, no. You know, the funny thing was, you're only allowed to grow 6 plants in Alaska, and because I write a garden column and people come and visit my house and everything, you know, I gotta be a little bit careful. So I only grew 6 plants last year, and this was the one plant I was testing. I had to have a control. It turned out to be a male plant on top of everything else. But no, I don't even know what kind it was. But its partner that didn't get the mycorrhizal fungi, small leaves, also a male plant. Unbelievable difference. Not obviously with teaming with fungi, I'm a believer anyway.
Sure.
But boy, if anything shows that mycorrhizal fungi is effective and is something that people ought to be using and is cheap, boy, cannabis plant is it.
Right? So that's something you discovered, mycorrhizal fungi?
Well, I don't know whether I discovered it, but mycorrhizal fungi leads me to what I'm excited about because there are a couple of other things coming online. One of them are endophytic fungi. Now, mycorrhizal fungi generally, 99% of that, are below ground, associated with the roots. Endophytic fungi are above ground, and there are up to 350, 450 endophytic fungi in that plant right there. They're not symbiotic, but they do various different things. One of them prevents cattle and aphids from eating on plants. We're learning how to make those, and so now there are a couple of endophytic fungi that people are experimenting with that are going to come on the market. There is a fungi that I found that they have in India. I don't want to get too much further, but it looks to me like it acts like a mycorrhizal fungi, even though it isn't, and so it might supplement the existing 4 mycorrhizal fungi that we know affect cannabis plants, and I think that's coming. I am certain that this company, in addition to having a phosphorus base, is coming up with new material. So, you know, you want to follow all of this stuff, new stuff coming out all the time, but it's microbial. And the final thing I'll say is that when you learn that companies like Bayer, again, I don't say Bayer, because I want everybody to remember that this wonderful company that just purchased that terrific company, Monsanto, you know, may have made some gases for a shower back during World War II in a concentration camp. But anyway, you know, they are testing a microbial nitrogen fixing seed coating, a microbial nitrogen coating that fixes not by making nodules with the roots, but just free nitrogen out of the air. They're all doing it. And they're doing it because, not because they're smoking cannabis, you know, but I think they're watching us. And they're figuring it out. They're certainly figuring it out. We know Scott's Miracle-Gro is trying to figure it out.
How about you, Colin? What's something that you've learned recently or gotten into that you're excited about?
If you can tell us.
Sure. I mean, I think as a microbiologist and we're basically a biotech company, a spinoff from the university, I think about the same things I thought about the university. My role has changed quite a bit from that of research scientist because I'm running the company and doing a lot of discovery and kind of touring the world in the cannabis industry, one grow at a time, one grow shop at a time, and that's my life right now. But it's really interesting. I learn a lot. I think overall, I think also about how we continue to bring value to growers. That's my job. That's always been my job, bringing value to agriculture, bringing value to producers and growers, and my focus is on the cannabis industry. I think this industry is evolving into a very professional, almost a commodity. And it's going to continue to do that. Where I want to make an impact is continue to figure out where there's pain points and find natural solutions for those. There are a lot of opportunities to continue to enhance yield and quality of this plant and other crops. And my focus is there. We reinvest everything into our company. We have an R&D team that's about 35% of the company. And all we do is think about ways that we can make new natural technologies that will bring value to growers. That's it. That's my job. And to make sure I can scale that where not only a hobbyist grower can use it, but a large-scale commercial grower can use it. It's economic. So we have to bring that value and that return. There's a lot of things that I think about, not only on the nutrient liberation side. We've talked a lot about how as we liberate and deliver nutrients effectively to plants and allow plants to maximize nutrient uptake, we can improve quality and yield, and that's great. I also think about the challenges with biocontrol or pests. And now we can bring natural solutions because there's a lot of problems across the world with using chemical solutions right now to control pests. And so from a product standpoint, that's what we look at. Nutrient delivery and control. We're working on those solutions. I think from another aspect, I think I'm really excited about this industry as a whole. You know, I just recently got back from Germany, and I've been in Spain, and we got product of the year in the UK, and I was in Israel, spent a lot of time in South America, and there's countries in every continent that are passing regulations, cultivation licenses, and they're gearing towards the international distribution of cannabis-related product. It's either flower or it's extracted flower for hemp and CBD or for THC-related products. Colombia is a perfect example, Canada is a perfect example, Israel is a perfect example. And this industry is becoming global. And I see this as a huge opportunity. I don't know when it's going to convert for the U.S. where we can take advantage of that. But on the federal level, I'll say if this industry was regulated, the U.S. could lead the world in cannabis production and exportation. I think that's an amazing position that I'm excited about, although I don't have a huge optimism of when that will occur. I don't have a crystal ball that works for that particular question. But I will say that there's a lot of opportunity, not only in our states, which we're kind of limited to right now to a large degree, but on this global scale. And the rest of the world is racing to occupy that space. And so I think there's a lot of, I'm very opportunistic in general and very positive about the outlook of cannabis cultivators and cannabis cultivation on a global scale. So I think there's a lot of opportunity to continue to capture. So we're just going to continue to push that.
No, I was going to add one other thing. We left out a couple of other things. Genetics, tremendous amount of stuff being done in genetics. A couple of companies that are tracking our genetics, what you think you're growing isn't what you're growing. Lighting, unbelievable advances in lighting. And what we're going to be able to do is now take the lighting from the natural area. So if you want to grow Durban Poison, which is South Africa, we can get the light profile from South Africa and duplicate that in our grow. That's pretty darn exciting. And I think we're going to be able to duplicate, in a sense, some of the microbiology in a way that's kind of exciting. A paper just came out a couple of months ago. They've discovered there are 511 bacterial types. I don't want to say individual bacteria, but bacterial groups that exist any plant in the world. Everything they test, they find these 511. Well, once we can identify those 511, we can tell which ones are missing. And we're going to be able to tell which ones we can add to that 511 to make them even more effective. So all of this stuff is happening, and it's just, it's crazy.
Yeah, to tag off that, then we'll pass over to John. I think what I like to talk about in some of the talks I give talks at a lot of different shows, is that I like to say that agriculture and growing is a team sport. Not only do we have to work with our community to learn and grow and share information, but technology change and we have to continue to be innovative. And we're talking about using microbes and innovative microbial technologies for this particular panel, but we are continually having to push the envelope. Competition's fierce, especially in California and Oregon and Washington right now. Continuing to push technologies for lighting and for environmental controls and different nutrient technologies and coupling those with natural and microbial technologies is critical to remain competitive. Not only do we have to maximize our output, but we have to minimize costs and our inputs and make sure they're as efficient as possible and that we get value out of those. And so thinking about that in the broader picture, I think is a really valuable umbrella thought to make sure that we're continuing to push the envelope and bringing value and using things that work really well. And I think microbes are a huge part of that, but it's not the only thing that anyone should focus on to maximize the value. And there's workflow, which is a huge part of it too. So there's a lot of things to consider in cultivating.
So back to you, John. I know you're an active researcher and you're constantly learning. What's something that you've gotten into recently that's gotten really exciting?
We've been researching and trialing out isolate of Metarhizium acetophyllae, which is a fungi that feeds on hard-shelled insects, and a cordyceps, and cordyceps is also the caterpillar fungus, and it will feed on soft-bodied insects. So you know, we have a combination of these two, and they kind of race to devour the insects that are in soil because, you know, there's a life cycle with thrips and different insects which go through the soil. Soil is the thing you want to save, and you want to be able to build up the microbial community in that soil. You know, I mentioned before the USDA and how they really gave, almost gave compostee a bad name here in Albany. But also, things have changed so much that just a few years ago, they have researchers that are being funded to look for potential insecticides that are also fungi. And one of those is Metarhizium brunium, and they've got a patent on that here at the USDA lab in Albany, and they're using that in golf courses now. And I don't know if you know anything about golf courses, but when I first went to Elaine Ingman's Soil Food Web Lab, I didn't know this myself, in Corvallis in like 1998, where I met Jeff, and you know, she asked the question, what is the most dangerous job in the United States? Right? And you know, crab fishermen, you know, all these people said different things. No one said greenskeeper. And the greenskeeper, once they started documenting the real workers at the greenskeeper, at greens and golf courses, they found out that they spiked in cancers. So that became the most dangerous job in America. And so it's good, and of course, all the greens are near wetlands. So it's good to see and exciting to be part of the collaboration that's going on between, I guess, mainstream now and cannabis in order to be able to protect the wetlands, protect the forests.
Right on, fantastic. So we've got about 10 minutes left, so let's go ahead and get a couple of your questions. Oh, right.
Hey, why you do that? Let me just mention something. So a couple of months ago, a lady called me up, a doctor, and she had a little gadget that measures microbial biomass. Have you heard about this yet? Okay, write this down, folks. www.microbiometer.com. So it's a kit you buy, $150, I don't know what it is. And then you take the test out in your field on your soil or on a product that you buy to determine what the microbial biomass is. And what this lady wants folks to do in the community is to test the system. For example, when your plants start to flower, they stop producing the amount of exudates that they produce in order to get to that stage. Well, you can tell with this microbiometer when that's occurring. So you can tell when your plant's about to flower. Holy crow, you know. So now we're gonna be able to have growers test and determine what's happening in their grow by using this little $5 or $10 test, which you can do in 5 minutes. You don't have to send it into the soil food web. Now, I'm not saying don't use the soil food web test because you need that as well. But this is something you can do very quickly. It can tell you whether what you're doing is working, which I think is key because we all need to be experimenting. Anyway, all
right.
Handing it to me. You're handing it to me. Damn it, Jeff. Why did you tell him that? I just spent $30,000 on a new qPCR.
Well, that helps too.
Okay, sorry.
Just need them both.
Hey, what's up, guys? This is Tate with Keto Life. I am also selling some microbial products, and one of the biggest questions that I often get, I know the answer to it, but I'd like to hear your gentleman's opinion, is, okay, so if I'm using these microbes, aren't I gonna fail microbial testing? What's your answer to that?
Well, it depends what state you're in or county you're in. If you're in Oregon, no problem. They have a choice between testing for insecticides and fungicides or the more complicated microbiology, so they decided microbiology isn't that important. Are you in Oregon?
I'm in Colorado.
Ah, well, Colorado, that's a Colin question.
Colorado is one of the strictest sets of microbial testing.
Yeah, even Nevada is even stricter. And so, yeah, that's an interesting question. I was actually talking about that last night on a podcast with Seth Poole and some of these other guys. It's a problem, and those guys are in those states. And I think to a large degree, the failings occurring, especially in some of those more xeric desert areas, because dust lands on the flower. These flowers are particularly sticky, and dust is vectors for microbes. And so you can actually fail through natural wind blown. And so that's a really interesting challenge, especially in deserts, and that's really restricted growers in Nevada in particular to grow indoors instead of using the greenhouses because of dust blowing, which is a shame. What I will say, and I asked this question, and we tested this pretty rigorously on our farm. I also have some farms in Colorado. We grow really high CBD strains, and we're getting some licenses for some medical higher THC strains as well. strictly for agriculture purposes. We can do stuff with that end product and get it to medical facilities for testing, but at the end of the day, this is about agronomics for me more than anything else. And we apply, it depends on how you apply. For Mammoth, we recommend using microbes as a soil drench. And we've tested this really rigorously. You know, it's almost impossible for the microbes and these free-living bacteria in particular and fungi to translocate from the roots and soil up through and land in the flower. The flower is what's getting tested, and so I don't see a concern about that at all. I'm a little more hesitant to tell growers to apply Mammoth, for example, as a foliar, because you're actually engineering higher CFUs or colony-forming units, bacteria, on the flower if you're spraying that on the flower, which I don't recommend. If you want to use a foliar, I would recommend using a microbial foliar early in the veg cycle or very early in the bloom, so you're not actually physically adding microbes. And so there's definitely trade-offs. I'm very, very confident. I've talked to some really sophisticated researchers in Austria also who are trying to get microbes to translocate from the roots or on the seed coating into the final flower product as a biocontrol, and they're really smart researchers and they can't make that happen. And so I think it's just thinking about how that microbe's landing on the plant and relating that to your management. And I think any microbe as a soil drench is not a threat.
That's where I've always came from. The thing that I've always seen was testing for Aspergillus and a lot of these other yeast and mold compounds. So in that particular style of testing, obviously, you're going to have a lot more contamination in a foliar feed than in a root zone feed.
Yeah, you know, air quality tests are pretty typical, and they test for those spore counts, and all those spore-forming fungi in particular are airborne. They blow, you know, you're breathing in spores right now as we talk.
We breathe like 3,000 a day.
Yeah, exactly. And so that's just a natural occurrence. And I think not only understanding the environmental quality of your air when you're growing, it helps you inform that threat in your growing environment for those tests. But then there's another piece, which is a slower process, but it's about educating and understanding. You know, BT is an example. Bacillus thuringiensis has been used as a biocontrol forever, you know, for a long time by huge companies. And that would test negative if you had high enough concentrations. It's a harmless bacteria. And so educating regulators to have that threshold of understanding what a good microbe is from a bad microbe, quote unquote, is important. And that's still a challenge for us, I think.
All right, next question. Oh,
Jeff,
you want to hit
this? I see it in Oregon. Gee, what is that white stuff on the outside of the Pinot Noir grape? You know what I mean? I don't get the emphasis on it. But I do think we're going to get the capability at some point in time to be able to do, even at home, RNA and DNA testing ourselves. I mean, I think it's coming. Before it comes to the home, I hope these idiot regulators, you know, get the equipment and identify what the stuff is. I mean, we know what the DNA is, so, you know, the testing becomes legitimate as opposed to harassment and employee-based, I have a job.
The reason that I bring it up is that so many people are becoming negatively stigmatized for microbes because of this microbial testing. That's big for California.
Well, and incidentally, in Denver, aren't they thinking about doing a radioactive implant into plants that are tested so that you can tell that your plant's been tested because it's got the radioactive marker on it? What? What?
All right, next
I got a question. Hey, James Rushing from White Coast Services. I provide consultation services, also microbiologist, and I'm right in line with what you guys do. Appreciative of all everything you do. I have a couple questions, like from the practical standpoint.
And your best one.
Yeah. So when I go on a consultation, it's not hard for me to go out and tell people that these things work, right? It's really the ability to quantify to them on a spreadsheet what are they going to get out of the value that you can provide. And so if I come at them and I say, over the next 52 weeks, you're going to have to spend, you know, $30,000 on Natrol to get rid of your nap problem or whatever it is. And then they go, oh, that's great, we do want to get rid of our problems, but we don't have the funds for that. We know it works, but we don't have an existing budget. How do you combat, specifically Colin, how do you combat that, as well, John, as well, how do you combat that when you're having that meeting, and they know that you can bring something, but we don't have the budget. It's just we can't do it, buddy. Maybe next quarter, you know.
Get paid a retainer 5 minutes after that conversation.
Okay, good advice.
And then consult one of us, and just throw it on our table. You know, I know Colin answers questions freely all the time. I do the same, and so does Jeff. He just said,
"We'll make you look good."
Yeah, you know, and it is a really changing game. I mean, I did say Oregon. You know, they're clearly not. They don't have any microbial screening on their flowers, but they just started microbial screening on their products because that's someplace that where they can make money instantly when you get fined for not having a certain level of CFUs of a certain, say, Bacillus subtilis that you have on your label. So they're building up their qPCR capabilities so that they can actually tell what these different organisms are. Great, you know, they'll be able to tell beneficials from harmful ones on flowers. That kind of answers this gentleman's question over here. Your question, well, you know, it's hard. I mean, there's a lot of people with a lot of hard money out there, and they're looking at what they're getting now, and they see that they've fallen very far short, and so they want to cut something out of the budget. You know, basically, they want to use some salt formula that's so cheap you can buy it at Home Depot and the cheapest soil in order to be able to just get something out there. But your product will be so substandard that it'll be really difficult to sell. And you know, that's even with substandard fertilizers, you know, my microbial program or a compost tea program is going to enhance some of the quality in it. You know, it's amazing how adaptive this plant is. You know, growing up in Northern California, I've been watching it since 1978. And I can tell you that the enforcement actually increased the adaptability and diversity of the plant. When the helicopters started getting lower and people moved back towards the forest, I didn't realize this because I was young at the time, which kind of got my interest in microbiology later, is that there's a lot of microorganisms that are on the bark and on lichen that came down onto the plants and started to modify the plants. They modified it because, of course, the people that are breeders started selecting plants that were adapting because they were looking better. So, you know, back to my point of they will see a difference. And if you were sitting here earlier when I said the difference could even be on the CO2 meter, you know, you gotta show them they're saving money somewhere and they're going forward with a program. And, you know, the people that are in it to win it are plant breeders now. So, you know, you have to have a certain section of that area that you're working in. You're bringing in, you know, the latest gelato strain or being able to breed plants yourself. I don't know if I just answered your question or just really strayed from it.
Right on. Well, we are over time anyway. Kyle, do you want to hit that real quick? Because it's not over.
I just think you need to quantify, and it's a math equation.
Yeah.
You need to display a return. You know, I don't think any farmer in any industry, in any crop, can afford to bring something in to pay for something that they're not going to get that return on. And you can quantify any return. It might take time, and it's always data driven, but you can show that cost of that pest over time that they're not mitigating, and you can show it in a lot of ways. You can show it in CO2, and you can mitigate that with lighting effects and everything else. And so there's a way you can quantify and show a return. If you can do that and it's compelling, you have a compelling value to offer to people.
Yeah, scare them by telling them they're leaving money on the table. So we've got to give up the room for the next event, but John, Jeff, and Colin are going to be hanging out a little bit. I know that, like, I saw at least 6 or 7 more hands that for questions, but for now, let's wrap this up and thank our panelists.
Thank you.